welcome here. My name is Emmanuel Salmon. I'm the science attaché at the French Embassy in Sweden, in Stockholm. And it is my pleasure to welcome you to this part of the day, which is an open panel discussion where you will have French and Nordic researchers presenting issues related to the urbanization of the Arctic. Just, you know, for those who arrived now, that there was a whole day of a workshop for these researchers, which has been organized under the general title of The Changing Arctic, which is a series of events that the French embassies in the Nordic countries organize. Today was dedicated to the urban Arctic, that was the topic here in Sweden, in Umeå. And then next week, on Monday, for instance, there will be a second event dedicated to health issues in the Arctic, and then there will be others until the end of this year. We thank the partners who supported us today. That's to say, of course, Västerbottens Museum here, ARCUM, the Arctic Research Center of the University of Umeå, and then there we have also support from Region Västerbotten and Mistra. It's not Arctic Futures anymore, it's Sustainable Development Program, and the Institut Français in Paris. So we will have a moderator, and I will hand the floor to him. He will be in charge of this discussion. And please, if you have questions at the end, don't hesitate to ask the questions.
My name is Olle Stjernström. I'm from the university here in the city. And I will try to share this panel discussion on urban Arctics, as we just heard. And we have a few persons in the expert panel, so let me just introduce them. And I will also allow them to present themselves or to say something about their specialties on this urban topic. But I must ask you to be super short, right? And we expect to have a number of questions from you in the audience, and if not, I will provoke you to start to discuss, because this is really interesting, actually. We have had a very extensive and intense discussion during the whole day, so we expect you to continue. So let me introduce then Brynhild Granås from Tromsø University, Sebastian Gadel from Marcel University, Toril Nyseth from Tromsø University, Hanno Heikkinen from Oulu University, and Rasmus Ole Rasmussen from an institute in Stockholm called Nordregio, or Nordic Center for Spatial Development. Was that correct? Thank you. So, Brynhild, would you like to start saying something about your interest of research?
Yeah. Like you said, it's been a long day, and do you want me to talk generally about what I've done, or more specifically what I've done on the urban, or what should I do?
Oh, just 30 seconds on your main interest in this urban Arctic research.
Yeah. My main interest in research right now is about our relationships to nature, which is an urgent matter. Mm. No matter what you study as a social scientist, or if you study culture, this is the urgent question, and it's very important to integrate, I think. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I've done research on different places in northern Norway where our university is. Toril and I have also worked together, and we have actually studied together the border town Kirkenes, which is on our border to Russia. We actually have a border to Russia, mm-hmm. Norway, they're up there. And we have done research in Narvik, which borders to Sweden. And I have also done research in Kiruna. Mm-hmm. So it's urban development and place development, because what you determine as urban is not that important in the type of research that I do. But I think we can return to this topic. Mm. I guess it will be part of our discussion.
Yeah, during the discussion. Thank you very much. Sebastian.
So about more interesting about by the ways of studies about the is working now. Okay, I'm to be like that, like the old fashioned. By the studies about the urban Arctic studies, I'm more focusing about the questions of the post-Soviet Arctic studies and developmental studies and the framework and the way, the aim issues is to understand the questions of the level of development and the transformation of society by the cross-crossing between the global warming, the question of political context and the transformation of the society itself and where we are going.
Okay, and I know you're from France, but you're also a position in Yakutsk.
Yes, yes.
Yakutsk is in, you know, Siberia, far, far away from here, but very Arctic. Turil.
My interest is has for several years together with Brynn on place development. We call it place reinvention once. Mm-hmm. Where we have a talk show actually from Norway, studying some of these cities or towns in the north, in actually a transition, a transformation perspective. Today I'm here because I've also made a study of urban Sami identities, because, I mean, the Arctic is urbanizing and so are the Sami. They are now living more in cities than maybe in the traditional Sami areas. And what does that mean, actually? What are the implications? And do we actually see a new sort of Sami identity emerging, which has the city as their main identity source, so to speak? I mean, they are not doing anything. They don't have anything to do with reindeers anymore if they are living their whole life in the cities, which more of them are doing today. So what does that mean for their identity? So that's one of the issues that
I'm sure we'll come back to that. Hanno.
Yes, I'm a cultural anthropologist, focused mostly on environmental anthropology. I started especially reindeer herding issues. I have studied both Finnish and Sami reindeer herding, and actually through this research I have been involved also research on tourism and mining industry and forestry, for example. And I think that my major interest is on local adaptation, and that's about it. And climate change is one of the recent topics that we have worked a lot, and
I think that's very good. And Rasmus, finally.
As you might see, I haven't got any microphone, but I'm pretty sure that after 40 years as professor at university giving lectures, I might be able to reach, but I can check with Tim. Can you hear what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's good.
Excellent.
It's for the recording that we need.
Oh, okay, okay.
It's not only to hear you.
Okay, I thought hearing me was the most important thing in order to create a discussion. But I work for Nordic Council of Ministers in Norregio, and we are doing a lot of analysis that are needed in connection with the policies that are developed for the Nordic countries. And furthermore, I've been living in Greenland for many years and work as consultant for the Greenland government. Has been living in Canada for a couple of years, and being as late as 2 days ago involved in a Senate hearing on housing problems in Canada. So urbanization, housing, these are some of the major issues that I'm working on.
Great. So now you have heard their field of expertise, and hopefully we have a lot of questions. And where do we start? So, I was thinking of maybe I should say something to begin with. So what we have explored today is more like the livelihood and urban sustainable development in the Arctic. And the Arctic is super big. It's a big geographical area. And it's about big business, it's about exploitation, it's about natural resources, but it's also about local communities and people living in this region. So there are so many things to say about this. There have been some recent events or recent developments that is really important to maybe discuss. So just let me give you some examples. Like what is going on when it comes to natural resources and the nature exploitation from various points of view? What about the gender and indigenous populations' rights and development? And what about the Arctic cities? So can we really discuss in terms of Arctic cities and find a way of navigating between form and function and you know, finding the special characteristics of the urban development or the urban environment in the Arctics? What do I mean by that? I mean, it's, you know, the cities has a general pattern, and the general pattern is brought from Italy and Greece. And they have somewhat slightly different climate. You might have been experienced that as well. So how could we transform this kind of universal ideas into the Arctics, building a sustainable environment or a sustainable urban environment for everyone? There is one example, or there are many examples that are interesting, like Tromsø in Norway, or Rovaniemi in Finland, or maybe even better, Kiruna, that is from the very beginning, is kind of climate adapted at its present location, I would say. But that would be some of the themes to begin with. But it's generally speaking, it's up to you what you would like to know, or what you would like to discuss or ask this panel about. So, by saying that, I ask the audience now, don't be shy and speak out. So we have Peter.
Okay. Yeah. Well, I thought we could have some different angles on the most general question on the theme we could think about. Mm-hmm. Arctic urbanization, opportunity or threat?
Well, that's a good start. Who would like to answer that? Hanno?
I'd like to start with this because I think that the key issue in Arctic areas is the vulnerability of Arctic in general.
So key issue in general in Arctic is vulnerability. And the vulnerability increases if urban cities and centers are centered on one livelihood, which seems to be rather common trend, tourism or mining, for example, or forestry, and
it doesn't work. We don't hear you.
Can I see?
Okay. We have to speak like rock stars. Okay. So vulnerability is related to economic development, and in Arctic it seems that really easily we are relying in urban areas on one major industry, and I think that that is one thing that we should really think about. Is it tourism or mining or forestry or something like that? Because then we are vulnerable to this boom and bust kind of developments. Mm-hmm.
But would you agree, or would you say that the Arctic economy is kind of this old-fashioned staple economy that we discussed today, that we are so much depending on the natural resources that the societies are also more vulnerable?
I think that diversity in livelihoods would be more secure strategy. Mm. That is my key message, supporting many kinds of ways of life and livelihoods.
Anyone else who would like to add to that?
No, just to add about what you said. Of course, the development of the cities and the sustainability of the Arctic cities depending about the economical activities as for them, the mining industries and the exploitation of natural resources and the tourism. Mm-hmm. But the exposures about the economical transformation are very strong, and especially when you are looking what's happens or what's happening in Canada, mm-hmm. or in Siberia. In fact, we have some ghosts and cities that disappear very quickly. Mm-hmm. And the question is to understand why there are some cities as we have the decline of the mine industry, the decline of some of our activities, we are mm-hmm. continuing to live and to grow and to continue their home life. Mm-hmm. And is what about what I am focusing more closely actually is on Yakutsk, because it's one of the example where the cities and continuing to grow and to develop has is not depending not only about the economical activities but also about the emergence about the new urban lifestyle, because it's deriving by some political interest, but also about some of the development of some new identities. And is also one of the way that it was why I was very interesting by the people that they speaking about the creation of emergence of a multicultural of a new values of a new aspect of multis and culturalities on the Sami people, because they have the same questions that we have on the minorities in Siberia or in Canada. In Canada, this is a collapse, of course, but in Russia, why is it working in some place and not in some other place? This is why we have to make a strong discrimination between the city that are totally related to the mine industries, city that we are developing the home business and service and the continuing. And we have some very good example, for example, that we saw in Sweden, in the north of Sweden, despite the transformations or the demographic evolutions and transformations, and is also one of the part of the sustainability.
But obviously we have a number of mining towns in the global north. So is there any chance that they will develop from a mining town to kind of an other kind of urban development or urban settlement?
The issue is one of the issues, how is and to maintain and to transform in fact from the mine industry to have the home life.
Mm. Yes, Lena Marie? Anyone? Rasmus? Yeah?
Because I think one of the qualities here in Umeå is the fact that there is a university. There are activities taking place in connection with the meeting, what's called the knowledge economy. And I think this is one of the aspirations for a lot of cities in the Arctic to become joining that group of the cities, because it provides the possibility of having a diversity in jobs, not only depending on one mining activities. In this connection, we have heard things about the iron mine taking place in Sweden, which is, I think, very interesting. I would like to mention in this connection that iron mines takes also place in Canada. For instance, one of the most known places is called Fermont, and those of you who are French speaking will of course know that it has to do with the resource there. The point is that when the Canadian government tried to do the same as which has been done in Sweden, the population living in that town objected to leaving the place. They were supposed to close the mine and bring people away. they objected to that, and then they started considering, well, how can we diversify our activities here up in the high north? And I think that's very inspirational in connection with what is my key issue here, namely that that diversity is needed, not only in order to create diversity in jobs, but simply to attract and keep younger people in the Arctic, because a lot of young people have no wish for going under earth and digging whatever resources, but want to stay above and share their knowledge and insight in connection with the development.
Yes, please.
Yes, I will. I think these are wise words from Rasmus. Mm-hmm. And I want to pick up on the question you asked earlier. Is urbanization in the north or in the Arctic good or bad? I was asked that question by a journalist the other day. When I answered something, but when I think about it now, it's really impossible to answer. Is it good or is it bad? Because urbanization processes takes place in so many ways. We want them to be sustainable. We don't want them to be based on politics that empty the rural landscapes where people live good lives, etc. So it's really not possible. But what I did answer the journalist was that I think it's very good in the north that we have urbanization processes, in the sense that for me, for example, it makes it possible to live in the area where I grew up, where I have my identity, but also possible to have a work life that I couldn't have in the more rural areas of the north. So I think your point is very important, Rasmus Ulrik.
But wouldn't that imply that some areas or some spots in the Arctic will be very much popular or populated, whereas other will be abandoned? Like everyone moves to Tromsø, Rovaniemi, Oulu, Umeå, Luleå, but what about the rest of the...
If you believe that it's only the light of the city that makes urbanization happen today, you might get worried. But that's not the case, because people actually enjoy life in small coastal communities in northern Norway and on the countryside. So it's about in northern Norway, the big issue is about the obligations for the big fishery industry to land their fish on the coast. Because if they privatize the big fish resources we have in Norway and just bring them out of the area and make money out of our fish without us getting a hand on it, our villages along the coast are emptied. And this is the type of important politics when we talk about urbanization in the north.
But in that sense, I guess Norway differs a bit from the rest of the Nordic communities. But Sebastian would like to say something.
Yes, it's not complete about what Remy said. Of course, I'm a Christian of a diversification, since it's very important, but one of the main points for the people, for the young generations, for older people, is to have, in fact, and to have the capabilities, in fact, to build some place that they are connected to the world, is the most important point. And to develop and to maintain and to improve, in fact, and the process of territorial integration as a hub with another over hub is one of the main points, in fact, that we can't, in fact, and to maintain and to develop, in fact, and this urban centers.
Yes.
And the problems of integration is one of the main points. Mm-hmm. And I'm totally agree about what you are saying, because there are some very good examples in Russia where there are no redistributions about the mine activities and the fishing activities, and everything is going straight to China, to South Korea, or to Moscow is one of the ways.
Yeah, exactly.
Absolutely. And is one of the most important points, and fixing the population.
Yes. But let me be a bit provocative then. I mean, in order to provoke a discussion, maybe, but I mean, who should really be in charge when it comes to, for instance, the resource in the sea, the fishes? I mean, how if you're not, I mean, as a fishing company, I said, more reliable, more profitable for me to land the fish in local communities, or would it be more profitable to land the fish in Reykjavik or elsewhere? And who should decide that?
So it's probably isn't face-to-face about the discussion that we have yesterday, you know, about the question of the integration of Sweden in the European Union, and to making the comparative and studies about and the program of land planning and the territorial and development and with Norway, and now we have sufficient time difference and to see the impact, because with the European Union is probably we have to provide some very specific urban plannings or some specific territorial planning to the north, and not to impose, in fact, and the standardized approach what is decided in Brussels or in because and the policy is not. This is the question of the adaptation of the European and policies into the north.
Right.
But is on the question, but is in the issue.
But a lot of the European policy is also about the competition between regions.
Absolutely.
So how could the European Arctic, for instance, compete with other regions in Europe? And where are the critical masses? Where is the best place of, you know, the investments? And also state investments. Rasmus.
I think, again, I like taking a circumpolar perspective on this, because one situation in one region might not be the best, and what I would like to promote in this connection would be community quotas. It exists in Alaska, for instance, which means that a community has a certain part of the total quota that is allotted to a specific country, in this case Alaska, and the same goes for instance in Nova Scotia in Canada on the east coast, where you also deal with community quotas. It means that everybody living in a community have some rights, but of course also the country need to make sure that profits are generated in general for the country in order to reduce the taxes or whatever, provide the healthcare, etc., etc. But community quotas would be my answer to your question.
Okay, interesting.
Yeah, maybe just a short comment then. We have a big success behind us in Norway. It's called the oil business. And when you ask who is going to make money out of natural resources, I think it kind of illustrates something. And actually the same goes a bit because you have for LKAB, because you have a state-owned mining company. So by the end of the day, if you're... the money that over the years has been brought in by this company has been part of building the welfare state of Sweden.
Yes.
So, yeah.
Anyone else contributing to this question?
No, just the remark.
Okay.
We didn't talk about when I was in Alaska. Last time I was very, very surprised when I talked with some colleagues from geographies of Guyana, but he's a geographer too. But we are exactly in the same situation than the Republic of Saha. In fact, we're totally depending about Washington, and they all the time making and go and back and to negotiate the budget and to try to have some money. And this is a question of a redistribution, so to have home capabilities for the local communities and to have a home budget and to use this home budget for the home development is one of the key issues about the development of the Arctic.
Of course. Sakha region in Siberia is huge. It's as big as India, but it only hosts like almost 1 million inhabitants, so you can imagine. But even this part of the world is rather sparsely populated, and we also have kind of an inner concentration or inner urbanization, which I try to say that we tend to move to the major cities in the European North. So what is your opinion about this urbanization? Should we interfere, trying to convince the individuals to remain, or should we develop some kind of measures in order to attract people moving to Glommersträsk or Moskosel or Vollerim or Storslett or all these small places that are losing people? People are moving out. So how would we be able to deal with this fact? Do you have any ideas? Should we have the right to live everywhere? Should we expect to be supported by the welfare state regardless where we live? Yes.
They are afraid, of course, for obvious reasons, because it's not that much support, not much security. But then what I see, for example, in Mombasa, just as an example, which is not that many foreigners, anyway, with these new networks that they are creating there, for example, the food networks that they are creating there, where they're connecting cities and the countryside so that people who are in the countryside, who are farming or something, they get a chance for a very good and stable income without any kind of intermediary or something, so that they get really just a good, decent life. Mm. Because the needs are not high as well when you are living in a different environment. So I was just thinking about this kind of solutions, how you can connect the countryside and the city, not just be stuck with the idea of knowledge economy, which I heard already in the panel discussion, meaning that what is about the contradiction then, as you see that regions are special and we need to go from the context and from the region, but then also adapt this knowledge economy that everyone prescribes now for everyone, everywhere. If everyone is in the knowledge economy, who's going to farm, who's going to feed?
Right.
And this is what I think is also just the question.
Well, to bring the question even further, why should we farm here when we can farm much better, much more less expensive in Southern Europe? Yeah, of course. Mm. Would that be something to consider? I mean, to develop the local economy, the local cooperation, to find niches in the economy that might develop the local conditions. Hanno?
I think that the key issue is we call company responsibility policies.
Social responsibility policies, that might be one of the key issues, how to bring together this neoliberal kind of market-based of economies and then rural development. And I give an example from Finland, where reindeer herding and tourism, of course they have conflicts as well and so on, but they are rather good mix, because tourism is creating markets for reindeer meat and locally produced reindeer meat. Mm. And that has been a recent 2 decades kind of development trend in Finnish reindeer herding, that reindeer herders are building reindeer meat processing facilities. And then they can sell directly to restaurants and tourism centers and so on. So it's a kind of a closed food chain idea. And I have heard that in Russia as well, some oil companies and gas companies are also buying, for example, reindeer meat from local herders and so on. So actually there is win-win solutions if there is will to cooperate and think about sustainability a little more broad way than just economic profit-making. Mm-hmm.
And Norway?
I would say that thinking a little bit into the future, we cannot transport food the long distances that we do. We can't do that if we are going the green way. Mm. And we have to.
Mm.
Don't you agree? to go, if we are going to be sustainable, we cannot transport goods the long distances.
Wouldn't that imply that we decrease the livelihood standard in the north? I mean, when we go to the grocery shop, we expect to find vegetables and fruits all year round from all the, you know, from the global market? Would that be impossible in the future? Rasmus?
Have you ever been to a Norwegian supermarket?
Well, I have.
Yes. Yes. Each time you want to buy brunost, then you need to go there.
Yeah, we have brunost.
But what you're talking about is basically what took place in the Russian mine on Svalbard in Pyramiden, the pyramid, because they produced vegetables, they had cows, they produced milk, and were more or less self-sufficient in what took place there. Right now, we are in the situation in Europe that there is a huge overproduction of milk, for instance, which decreases the price and makes it difficult for farmers actually to live on producing some of the food supplies. But it was not this I actually wanted to address.
Okay.
I want to address another issue, namely an important point for a lot of young people with living in a city is that, of course, there are a variety of shopping possibilities, etc., etc. But at the same time, there is much more open to free speech and free discussions. And I would like not to mention any Nordic countries right away. I'll do that a little later. But I would point to Canada, where, for instance, village life. You cannot, as a researcher, go to a village and try to see, well, who are the good guys, who are the bad guys, because you need to send them all your questions in advance, and then the top guy is sitting and regulating the community, and I think in Norwegian it's called Nessekongen, that is the one who makes the decisions, and very often is the person that children molesting, rapes and things like that. But you cannot investigate such things, and I wouldn't say villages in the Nordic countries in general are in this situation, but the openness to accept differences and make life livable for new generations, not mimicking what the previous generation had decided on. I think this is probably one of the most important issues in connection, for me at least, in connection with living in cities.
So what are you saying then, that we should abandon the traditional society, the family valued, or the traditional family values, or to liberate ourselves, or?
Well, but now you generalize.
Yes,
that's probably the most the worst thing you can do in this connection, because the older generation should take their positions and have their opinion and have accept what they think is acceptable, but they should not have impact on what should be available for young people. I could mention a very bad case from the Nordic countries. There are no people here from the Faroe Islands, as far as I have seen so far, and there the religious part of the population objected fully to other sex relations among the population, which meant that, for instance, gay people moved to Copenhagen, not that it's a wonderful place for gay people necessarily, but simply because they are not allowed to be on the islands. They were hunted by the older generation and were kept outside, let's say, the good party of the country. And I think issues like that is, especially for the upcoming generation, extremely important to be able to conduct your own life without the control of the older generation.
And do you think the upcoming generation will adopt the same kind of strategy in relation to their own children?
Again, I can only talk on behalf of my own children and my grandchildren, and the answer is yes.
Oh,
if you are grown up under open conditions, you'll continue the rest of your life to accept open conditions, while
the previous generation were growing up under, well, much more limitations, mm-hmm. and that impacts their perception of what should be allowable and what should take place in the future.
I agree. I mean, we belong both to the liberal, you know, generation. But I just read this very interesting article the other day that there is a kind of a new movement in opposition to this, that young people really like strong leaders and traditional family values, and there is a movement back to that, which also relates to the fact that nationalism is growing much stronger in Europe, or even in the Nordic countries. So, I mean, it fluctuates maybe between the generations. So if we belong to the liberal generation, maybe next generation would be something else that we don't know.
The next generation from my household.
Okay, I'm glad to hear that. Yeah. Okay. Any more interesting questions? Or all questions are interesting, of course. So
I don't think we answered the question of the young man really about his suggestion. Toril, you said something about it, and that is also in line with what I was thinking. And talking about openness and diversity, I think it's very important to recognize such types of initiatives. These are people who are creating the world. Mm-hmm. We cannot in 50 years bring in our meat from the other side of the world. I don't think so. And it's up to us in a democracy to decide also what kind of society we want for the future. Mm-hmm. So this should be supported, these types of activities. Mm-hmm. And I was actually thinking about my uncle when you said that question, because we have a tradition for this type of connectedness between the countryside and the city. He was every summer and or in the autumn, he was in the town selling his vegetables every day. Mm. He was a character in the town. Mm. And people were delivered fresh vegetables, and they were homegrown and high quality. Today, the people in that town go to a poor supermarket, because supermarkets in Norway doesn't work. It's just cheap food. That's, it's about how it is organized. But they don't have access to vegetables that are produced locally, that are produced in sustainable ways. So there is some type of development that we have to turn. And maybe I think your idea was very good, to think about this as a kind of integration also of activities and economies between the town, to see the relationship between the town and the surroundings.
I have to, yeah, please. Sebastian was first, actually, and I have a follow-up question to you.
It was the follow-up.
All right, okay, please, go ahead.
Just that, there's a movement going on today about smart cities, about urban growing, also in large amounts, because we're not only talking about the small gardens, but also huge innovations also related to how to produce in large amounts, also in an urban context. So there's a lot of going on now, so just be aware.
Absolutely, I agree. Sebastian.
Yes, what I could, in fact, to talk about then the both sides about the creation of a food safety, in fact, and the access about some types of food or not. And just what I can take as the example of Siberia, where I am working, and it's very funny because I am mapping, in fact, and the place where there are a strong impact of the sanctions and some place where any impact and why. Of the sanctions, and it's very simple. If we are taking a lot of mine industries, as you mentioned, in fact, we are totally depending about the coming of a daily airplane that is coming there with the food and for Moscow, mm-hmm. and the impact is quite high. And at the opposite, you have some other place because of the coming of Asiatic and mostly of South Korean, but we're implementing, in fact, some farms or wheat farms. We have since some years only, some tomatoes, some salad, and some new thing, and it changed totally then the life.
Mm-hmm.
Then, as you know, as me, then Yakutsk, you have to imagine that 10 years ago there are no salad, there are nothing. It was because of the coming of a South Korean, because they had decided to come here, but we have in fact never growing up, and we can see in fact, and I don't think that there is an homogeneous. But there are strong differentiation according to the different place about the question of the accessibility to the food or not the food and the price, everything is one of the main points. The second point, of course, we cannot. We are talking about the coming back about some traditional values in some young people, in some families, but okay, sure. But you have to understand in the same times that when you are working the south part of Siberia, 70% of the people, 80% of the people, they are not moving. They are moving just to the dacha and they're coming back. And this is them life. And they don't understand why there are some of the people that decide isn't to go into Europe. And you have this strong contrast is also links between the capacities of the minorities and to take or not the capabilities and to be then globalized or not. This is why then I ask you how then the young and Sami, they are developing the home values and the home behaviors and then the capabilities in fact and to work on the local level, or the global and the local level. And we saw this difference between the Russian and the Ukrainian and so, or with some other than minorities, because when you are with some nomadic than population, so we are writing an article now with some anthropologists, we are showing that the people, they are a strong secinercy in types of life as nomad. They have a high level of mobility, and some people they are totally then fixing. And, this is why it is very interesting then to see with the emergence of a urban lifestyle, what is will be happens and what is happening in the multicultural approach.
I would very much like to come back to the question of identities and minorities. But first of all, I would like to turn to you again. So it's interesting what you say, this idea of local production and the local market and the problem with this, you know, chain stores that are connected to agreements that are decided on another level, which means that it's impossible for them to buy from the local producer, for instance. But I think also there might be a lack of knowledge about consumption behavior or consumer behavior. Do we really know how the consumer relate to the offers or the assortment? How do we pick our daily food? So, which implies that also this relates to the question of social and economic sustainability in the household. Or?
I want to disagree now. The problem of Norwegian supermarkets. I guess it's quite boring for you. But just to indicate something, it's not we as consumers that decide by buying frequently what is in the store. It is the capital behind the people that want their goods out in the store. They can buy a place in the stores in Norway.
Okay.
And they can buy a certain place. And they make agreements that leave other suppliers out. So it's not consumer driven. It's something else. Yeah. So if we want to talk in that language.
Well, but if take me myself as an example, then I'm a high incomer and I can, you know, I can afford to buy the locally produced. And I can avoid ICA Maxi. I can go to these kind of nice stores downtown and buy locally produced fish or meat, or it's quite expensive. And it's not for everyone, I guess. If I go to ICA Maxi, I can buy milk from Finland, Valio, or Germany, or from all over the world. And it's, I guess for many people, it's a mix of the quality and price. But I can choose to go somewhere else to buy the locally produced and support this beautiful idea of connect the consumer with the local.
Well, I don't
production.
Know how you're doing in Sweden, but in Norway, the families are pushed economically on the cost for housing. Mm. That is the part that you really had to pay a lot
okay.
for, and not on food, if you compare in historical analysis of what people. But the public discourse is that, oh, the food is so expensive, it has to become more cheap. And
is that why all Norwegians go to Sweden then?
Yeah, I go to Sweden to the grocery. I think it's like coming into a Norwegian delicatessen butik to come in a normal Swedish supermarket. So,
okay.
Yeah.
All right. We you waved, so
yeah.
You have a question.
How do they perceive themselves in this kind of context in the longer range? And this neoliberal context we were speaking about, focus on self-actualization and so on. How does that affect how do you distinguish with that, like Samis and Norwegians in Toronto, for instance, and how they perceive themselves in the city?
Very clever question. It's my student, so.
Okay. Yeah.
Sure. Yeah?
Yes. I'm not sure if I can answer that on a very general basis. You probably know that I have been made a study about urban Sami and also the young urban Sami, which in my opinion is a young generation that's experimenting with their identity based on high mobility. Very many of them are quite mobile. They test out different places, different cities, and out of that comes perhaps a new sort of urban Sami identity, which is something else that we have probably known before. Mm. Where they mix, they mix identities. They mix between and they play maybe much about both with symbols and how they express themselves as Sami. And they choose so to speak when to be a Sami, when to be Swede, Norwegian, and all that. So they are less a burden with this history of colonization and repression.
But these Sami youngsters do they differ from other youngsters? Are they as mobile as others, or are they? I mean, growing up is more or less a question of finding your own identity. That's a process. So I mean, when you have worked with the Sami youth, do you find them?
They are actually as mobile as everybody else.
Right. Okay. Thank you. We had a question over there, please.
Yes, and that's, it's, as I thought in my talk before, it's differences between the generations, because particularly between those who have moved from a rural area, a Sami district, a Sami by, and to the urban environment, they keep their identity from the place where they come from. So it's more about if they have been born in the city or not. But there are also examples of those who actually have been born in the city, but where their grand parents are from a Sami community, and where they actually gather or identify with the, for instance, the costume from that area, because they don't find those Sami symbols to identify in the city, mm-hmm. so they have to get them from.
And they do. Interesting. Lena Maria.
It's a little interesting to hear the expert's view on something you have a lived experience of. So I'm the mother of three young Sami, city Sami boys. And my experience is that they would not dress like I. I said, I can make you a Sami dress and they won't wear it. But they are very happy when I do a mobile phone envelope in a Sami style. Mm. And they are proud to wear it and they are proud to use it. So that's one image of the city Sami next generation.
But would that imply that we are also losing identities? Do we get lost of identities?
I don't think we can talk about losing identity, because identity is always changing.
Yes. Okay, interesting.
So
Hanno.
That's my point as well. So the concept of identity, we should understand it as dynamic and layered. We all have several identities, and it depends on to whom we speak about.
Right.
If a Spanish person asks me about whom I am, the answer would be different compared to the Sami or whatever. So it's as well as culture, both are dynamic.
But do we tend to use different identities in different contexts?
Yes. Probably yes. Mm-hmm. It depends on the place, of a context, and of course, and the identities, and we are moving according to the place, according to the people.
Mm-hmm.
And it's very simple. When you are coming back to your village, you don't have the same and bear of yours and meaning as the clothes of as you are coming back to Stockholm or to some other place.
Mm-hmm.
You have these capacities of mixing the different identities or to play with these identities.
But there are many stories of mixed identities that are also kind of sad stories. You are not really connected to your parents' identity, and you have a mixed identity that makes you unsure. I don't know.
I don't know also, but I don't know if you can talk of mixed identities or the building of new identities that they are just adapting to the context where we are.
At the moment, yes.
The moment.
Right, okay. Hanno.
Just an example of this positional nature of identity.
Please, closer, yes.
Forum or context would have been different, and you asked me about define myself, like who I am, and tell something about you.
Mm.
I would have started in another context with the sentence that I am son of a farmer, not cultural anthropologist. In this context, I started with cultural anthropologist, but still both are part of my identity. I come from farming house and village and so on, but in different context, I would have used different definition of myself, but still, it's me that I'm talking about.
Right. But could it be the case that there are in a society that there are certain identities that are not that popular, that young people, for instance, tend to avoid or hide because it might be problematic? Or yes, please.
Yeah, part of we can talk about identity as shifting and layered, and I'm totally in on that. But we also have to, I think, see that some types of identities have a kind of deeper meaning emotionally and politically. For example, gender, and for example, ethnic identity.
Mm-hmm.
And your question is, of course, one answer could be, yeah, racism would be a kind of identity situation that makes people hide their, what they perceive as their identity.
Mm.
And to your question earlier, I think it was more addressed towards the young Sami people. But if you open the bit up, I think that in what you see in the north these days, and I think it's very much related to what Turil is talking about, what you see is northerners and young northerners, I mean like me, no, that was a joke. I mean those who are maybe from my age and younger, that nurture a type of different types of cosmopolitan identities. So it's about mobility. It's about us all being on the internet. It's about, you know, being global citizens. And I think it is very important. And I think it brings hope in.
Okay, time is running. I would like to implement a new subject, if I may. We had a very interesting discussion about the Same Villages cooperation with the LKAB in Kiruna about, you know, getting along, coming along. And I mean, what characterizes this northern part is that it's really sparsely populated, but we have economic interests that covers huge land areas. So reindeer husbandry, of course, forestry, hydropower, mining, tourism, and so on. And they demand a lot of land. And that is also a challenge in planning. And sometimes these interests come into conflicts, land use conflicts, we tend to call it. So is there an opportunity for this, all these important land use interests in the north, like reindeer husbandry, mining, forestry, hydropower, fishery, oil and gas, whatever. So is it possible to find a way of dealing with this in the planning system and in the economic system?
Well, what you are making reference to is what's called multifunctionality, the fact that different activities can take place parallel in specific areas and landscapes. Of course, you need then to regulate in order for one activity not to have negative implications for other activities. But basically, it's a matter of consensus on how to deal with it.
I forgot to mention one of the most influential, and that is nature preservation or conservation. So it also covers huge areas of land. So that is also part of this. Hanno?
I think that we should also accept the situation that not all land uses can survive in the same area. So sometimes, for example, reindeer herding, tourism, mining can be that kind of land uses that we have to choose.
Okay.
But of course, it depends on will also. If we want to find solutions, there probably is at least some sort of solutions for smaller harm, for example, and so on. But I think that in some point, there is also situations where we cannot unite all interests to the same area.
Rasmus, you would like to say something? Yes.
Just one comment, because we heard before that oil and gas development in Norway has currently contributed to the wealth of the country. I would like to put a little salt in the wound in this connection, because one way of solving that problem is to do what Statoil does, namely invest in oil sand development in Canada.
Yeah, they do.
Which creates a lot of problems for the local population there. So you don't see it. It's out of sight. It's put away.
Both Turil and I are totally against that. So,
Oh, okay. Sebastian.
Yeah, so that was like, in fact, and to talk about one extreme case where we made some walking trip last November. It was before then the closed town is Mianich. Mianich today is 20% of the world product of diamonds. And when you are going into Mianich, of course, you are in fact in the territory that is totally under control by Alrosa. This is the state company that is making the extractions of the mining. And in realities and the questions of land use, the land development and the urban development are totally under control by the representant of Al Rosa in the old town. Mm. And we are some meetings, some participation to help them, in fact, to try to diversify the activities of the cities, and also they have some new project, you know, the very deep, big mine, you know, of more than one kilometer deep. Mm. They want, in fact, to transform, in fact, on this one, they have some incredible project. I don't think so, but it will work. And they asked them, because we came with some colleagues from architectures and for environment planning, and to try it and to help them, so to develop that. But in realities, when there are some very, very strong economical interest, in fact, we are in the strong and privatizations of the land, of the territories, and everything, and the capacities of the locals and communities and to interact are very limited, as theirs. And and sometimes, okay, so we are giving them some rules according to this one, but who is in the real capacities of the locals and communities and to express what they want.
Okay.
And sometimes I'm quite critical about the ideas that the mine industries, of petrol industries, of course, and they are doing some effort and to protect and to support some activities for the locals and population, but until where? And we have many examples, especially in the north of Siberia, where the coming of the mine industries of oil and petrol totally transformed the locals and population. And we have in this mixing, we are very happy because they are paying the educations, they are paying everything, and the part of them that are going to Novosibirsk, to Moscow, to St. Petersburg, continues in the studies, the part they are totally then destroyed by this aspect, and there are also then the financial aspect. And this is why we have a lot of contradictions. About
of course, yes.
And I don't think so, but there are one policy, one views, or, and I think that each case in terms of sustainable development is unique.
I will come back to that. Yes, please.
Yeah, and I think this is very interesting and important, and this is why I was mentioning the Norwegian oil. It's not about Statoil, because they are doing what many other global, globally operating companies are doing that.
Sure.
I think we have to regulate much harder. But what I was talking about was the taxation of any oil company that comes and picks up oil in the North Sea, etc. So we have made money on it, and I think that is the preferred model instead of leaving it to corporate social responsibility thing, meaning a company should take, you know, care of its surroundings. Then you have a kind of regulation between the industrial actor and people living there that is not democratically regulated.
It's a patron-client.
So I think it would be much better if the schools got money that were brought in through tax systems and distributed in democratic ways. So that is still, for me, a preferred societal model. I don't know if you are with me. Democracy.
Well, we can discuss. But first of all, we have a question, I guess, in relation to this topic. Yeah. Could we have the question first, please?
I just would get to
okay, very answer, briefly.
Very brief. Yes, and about that, and some 2 years ago in the Russian Duma, they have, in fact, in the special commissions about that. And how is that making the regulations and the use of and the money for the locals and population and to develop them home right. I mean, after I participate at the first expert sessions, we have some strong fighting, and we close forever these sessions because they want to impose their home view. And I don't think so, but we have the capacities of the powers and to impose to the global enterprise the right on some very limited aspect. And
since I myself come from this research community, I don't do research in this area, and I don't know the discussions that are happening, but that in line with what they were discussing, how are the recent TTIP and all this kind of agreement being discussed in the Arctic research community? How the Canadian maybe experience being brought in, and is it being raised as an issue or is it threatened?
like to answer? Rasmus?
A quick answer is that a lot of these concerns ought to be a part of Arctic Council activities. The problem is that the mixture of countries involved in Arctic Council means that you cannot make any decisions that has any implications for the population. You can make a lot of decisions on weather forecast, on climate change, whatever, but in the US they won't accept any decisions that you should treat your population better or things like that. So the organizations that ought to be in charge of that is not able to do it.
Yeah? Yeah, go ahead, please.
No, it was just a comment about this conflict between area conflicts. I think they will increase in the future.
Okay.
Between different interests.
Mm.
And we see it already related to mining. But we also see it in Norway in the sea, you know. Not only about the petrol, I mean, we have a petrol-dependent economy, but it's also about the fish. Because after the oil, it's fish farming and then cod fisheries. So it's been the new and the old economies fighting for the same territory. And so there's a lot of conflicts coming up now, because fish farming is a very capital-intensive company. Big companies, very aggressive
global companies,
taking over more and more sea areas, which also, of course, is areas for traditional fisheries.
Yes,
but there's conflicts on there.
Right. I would like to raise another issue now, because time is running very fast, and that is the relation between here and there, core periphery, we say. In science language. Let me take an example again then. So I've been residing or living here up in the north since, I don't know, 1981, I think. But I was born and bred in Stockholm. And up here you refer to people from Stockholm as 08, which is the regional number when you call someone in Stockholm. And I guess so, which expresses some kind of, you know, a relation between people from the region and outsiders. And I will be an outsider as long as I live here, because people refer to me as a guy from Stockholm. And when I was in Yakutsk, I asked about their relation to Moscow and, you know, the central government and all the central decisions. And they said, you know, that's the people in Moscow, who cares? I mean, they can decide whatever they want to decide, but we are following our own ideas. Which felt me, oh, that's nice to hear. Because that is what you also experience here, that all right, the politicians, the parliament, the government in Stockholm, they have decided that, all right, so let's find out how to deal with that. And I guess you are familiar with same kind of attitudes in Norway and in Finland, Denmark, I really don't know if Greenland have a special relation to Copenhagen in relation to this issue. But I mean, to talk more seriously, how should we understand the relation between the national cores and the national peripheries? Because in our context, this part of the world relates to the periphery in the national context and in the European context.
Well, you know, I come from a colony, an internal colony of Norway. That's northern Norway in a way. And that's how we perceive ourselves. We don't use that word colony, but district. And this is what we were taught by our parents to really, you know, not hate, but, you know,
to combat?
Combat the South and Oslo. But I think, back to this question about these TTIP negotiations, now he's left this guy, but this type of what is happening when it comes to deregulating further the global markets, I think it's a good challenge for Arctic research to take in this level in analysis, because we are used to, you know, discussing the power in the south, but we are not that familiar, I think, in my area, in research in Northern Norway, to take in this global finance dimension of how our societies up there are produced. Mm. And it is there exactly through, for example, fish farming, a very, very rough industry, destroying fjords and species and everything. So I think it's a good challenge for us to focus in this level better in our research.
Mm. Okay. Any more comments on the core periphery issue, Hanno?
Yeah, center periphery relations are really critical also in Finland, of course, and it's not relying on like north, south, only east, rural areas. These are periphery areas, and there is rather critical attitude. But I think that mostly the key question is power relations. Who has the power to dominate someone else? And there will be always conflict with this kind of relation. Wherever this power center is, is it in the EU or wherever? Actually, if we want to get rid of this kind of center-periphery dilemmas, we should share the power
Right. So let's ask the audience then, because we have an ongoing discussion, or almost a political decision, even though not yet established, that we might implement much larger regions in Sweden. So in up here in the northern part of Sweden, we discuss in terms of the big region Norrland, which is the four northernmost counties. And that would be kind of a regional parliament, and that might put the local communities in charge. But I don't know. How do you see it? What do you understand of this idea of implementing a larger region? Have you heard about it? No? Yep. Okay, but how do you feel about this, you know, kind of relations between where you live in your local community and the central level in this county, like Umeå, for instance, or the central bureaucracy in the south of Sweden, in Stockholm? How should we understand that? Peter would like to say something. Yeah, please go ahead. Of course.
I talk to express a worry that they will be alienated from power and the government structures will change. Mm-hmm. And as we say, when the power went to Brussels, now people will say that the power will go out of the regions to whatever capital will have the power in this region. And they see a threat in it. There might be positive things too, but they are not as immediate.
Any reactions? Rasmus, again?
Well, I want to object to some degree to your point of view, because if I should make a comparison with the situation in Greenland, as I told earlier, there used to be 18 municipalities, now they are reduced to 4. Mm. And the reason was simply that in order to delegate responsibility to major issues to the previous communities were too small. So by merging them, you reach a level of population and activities that enables the delegation of the responsibilities out to the communities. And to me, it seems to be sensible and reasonable. But the same took place in Denmark for, I think, 10, 12 years ago, from 250 municipalities to 98 municipalities. And again, for instance, responsibility for controlling the environment was moved from Copenhagen
out to the larger municipalities because they had the capacity to deal with these issues and thereby bringing the decisions closer to the local population. And it has worked in many ways.
The coins always have two sides. You know, this is very, very interesting. But now time is 5:30, so we have to round up. And it has been a pleasure to guide you through this discussion, even though it was not that very easy, but anyway, very interesting. So thank you to you all in the audience, and thank you to all the five panelists answering.